Hey, hey, what's up, Control Po? Welcome to Control Talk Now, where we talk about all things HVAC and smart building controls. This is your show for the week. This is your show for the week ending October 15th, 2023. This is episode 429. My name is Eric Stromquist. I'm so glad you're here. It's been a minute. My kids had fall break, so we did a little traveling as a family, and was sort of a lack of guest, for lack of a better words. But I'm going to make up for that today because I've got a fantastic guest coming up in just a few seconds. But before we get to our guest, a word from this week's sponsor, Controls Group North America.
The world of distribution is undergoing an incredible transformation. And if you want to be at the forefront of the change, then you need to join a community that is working towards redefining supply chains. CGNA is that community. By bringing together the best distributors with innovative manufacturers, we are changing the game by finding ways to solve problems, cut costs, and increase market share for our members. As a member of CGNA, you'll have access to exclusive resources, expertise, and knowledge, including access to intermember inventory. As a manufacturer, you have the opportunity to reach over 208 locations with the support of highly trained and motivated CGNA members. Together, we're redefining distribution and creating real value for our customers. So why not be part of something bigger than yourself? Join CGNA and let's ride the waves of change together. Welcome to a world where synergy reigns supreme.
Yeah, well, part of what I did, I was actually in Indianapolis at the Controls Group North America Fall Conference. And I tell you what, this is the best of the best. It's the best distributors. It's the best vendors. It's the elite. So I shot a bunch of videos at their vendor showcase, which I'll be showing over the next couple weeks. But Controls Group North America is, they're special. It's a special group. If you're a vendor and looking to increase your reach, CGNA is a great alternative. And if you're a distributor and you cut the mustard, hey man, getting together with the rest of like-minded distributors to create value is the way to go. But without further ado, I'd like to introduce our guest this week. I am so excited catching up with an old friend. We hadn't heard from him in a while, although he's been out and about. My guest is Troy Harvey, the founder and CEO of Passive Logic. Man, Troy, thanks for taking a few minutes to speak with us.
Yeah, thanks for having me back, Eric. This is super fun to be able to talk to you and talk to your audience.
Awesome. Awesome. Listen, for our audience that maybe hasn't heard of you, and our audience is global, so we pick up new people every single day. Walk them through, give them the 10,000 foot view of Passive Logic.
Sure. So Passive Logic really started a few years ago. We saw what was happening in the rest of the tech industry, and particularly autonomous vehicles. And we thought, wow, autonomous technology is better suited for buildings than it ever was for vehicles, because we have all these things that we're trying to organize and automate and collect together under this one roof of a building. And it's not just like one car, right? Like in autonomous vehicles, you're navigating one car in a city. In a building, we have this whole fleet of subsystems that we're trying to coordinate. And we realized that there was time that we needed to really move this industry forward. The last startup in this industry to really sort of revolutionize what we were doing was Tritium. And that's now 25-year-old, right?
Yeah.
And so imagine if we were in our personal lives in 25-year-old technology, right? Like we have iPhone 14s, iPhone 15s at this point. And 25 years ago, we were just barely using flip phones, right? So it's this industry, we're really excited about it. We're really excited about building technology for you guys that sort of brings us up to 2023 and what 2023 should be all about. So that's the cornerstone of Passive Logic, is building autonomous technology for buildings.
Yeah, and I want to say, man, I've seen what you guys are up to. It is super super cool. And in fairness to some of the other vendors out there, you guys have there's a company called EZIO that came out years ago. Johnson Controls bought them. And Mike Marston and Lim, they had an advantage because they didn't have an installed base, right? They got to start from scratch. And I think what maybe holds some of the bigger players back is not only are they trying to be innovative, but at the same time, they have to take care of their existing database. And not to sound callous, that's a them problem and they're handling it. But I think it does give companies like yours an advantage because you're starting with, hey, if we were going to build a control system today with all the technology that's available, how do we build it?
I think this is one of the differences between the new tech industry and the older industrial industry is the willingness to disrupt yourself. And it gets hard when you get to be a big company to take the risk to disrupt yourself. In the tech industry, yesterday we spent a bunch of time with Apple engineering group and NVIDIA. We can talk a little bit about how we're collaborating with both those companies here. But one of the things that both those companies did is Steve Jobs and Jensen at NVIDIA, they bet the company multiple times, and it was maybe a risky thing to do, but that's how you change the game, right? If you get stuck where you are, you never change the game.
Yeah.
But I can understand if I was the CEO of many of the other incumbent companies, it's a tricky business to do it differently than what you're doing.
And of course, once you guys get your base going, then you'll pull them along too, and you'll be very cognizant of the people that invest early with you guys. So it's a cool thing. Obviously, if you're talking to those guys, we're going to have to talk. We're going to have to use the A word, the AI word, because without giving away, because for our audience out there, Troy's basically here to talk about, man, he has got a huge event that's coming up where he's going to reveal a lot of the secret sauce and what's going on. So maybe, Troy, before we drive into the weeds, maybe we'll start with that.
Yeah.
Tell people about the event that's coming up and what you're going to be doing there. And then we'll circle back around to some Silicon Valley type topics.
Yeah. Some of you guys in the industry, we've been under NDA with, we have to a select group shown some of what we've been working on. We've had a booth at HR, but we've kept ourselves a little bit in what I call semi-stealth as we've been building out this technology. So November 2nd, we're going to have a worldwide live stream event that we're going to unroll what Passive Logic's been building for the last few years and really show people these four pillars of what the Passive Logic technology is. So the first pillar, we talked about autonomous systems for buildings. Second pillar is this computable digital twin technology. And that digital twin technology, that changes the game of how we think about AI. And not just the building automation systems, but all kinds of industrial systems. Pillar number three is this whole ecosystem of digital twin applications that allows us to design for the equipment that we design for manufacturers. How do we build the digital twins for those? How do we design buildings for architects and engineers? How do we do the scanning and the extraction of all these buildings that we have out there in the field that nobody has plans for? You go to a site visit and you're going to do a analysis of like, how much is my project going to cost? Where do I get the plans? There's no plans, right? So scanning that into a set of plans, Autonomy Studio, which maybe some of your users or viewers have seen us in the past show an early version of Autonomy Studio. And then some of these tools in the maintenance and management side of the building. So what Passive Logic has built is this whole end-to-end ecosystem of applications that all talk digital twins, and it just connects up one to the other. And lastly, some really cool AI compiler technology. Now, this may not be what this audience is gonna use directly, but what Passive Logic's been building to make autonomous buildings possible is this compiler technology that really speeds up AI a lot. So we're now 300 times faster than Google's own AI platform called TensorFlow. And that's really important for how do we do edge-based at the building level AI, not just in the cloud. And so that's another thing that we'll be revealing. And that's part of why I'm out here in the Bay Area this week.
Oh, no, Troy, it's cool. And I've seen, because you guys have been working on this, cooking this up for a while, and it is very disruptive. It is really cool. It is not just going from a gas car to an electric car. It's like going from a horse and buggy maybe to a car. or a jet plane. It's huge. So let's break down. And obviously this event, you're going to be rolling it out. So people that want to get in the weeds with that, you definitely want to sign up for the event. We'll have a link in the show notes so you'll know how to get involved with that show. But all right, so let's break down some of the components. So let's talk about, you used the term digital twins a couple of times, and most of my audience knows what digital twins are. First of all, give me your definition of digital twin, and why is that important to what you guys are doing?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. What is a definition of digital twin? And I think digital twins as a topic are talked about in so many different ways. So we as a company had to really come up with a rubric of what is a digital twin? Because when people talk about digital twins, a lot of it is BIM in the cloud is how I put it. If you put BIM in the cloud, does that make it a digital twin? We think that's still BIM, right? There's no need to have a marketing team relabel what we're doing, right? If something has a name, it should already have that name. It stays that name. So what we think of about what is a digital twin, it's all of these different technologies brought together under one roof. So it is BIM in the cloud, right? It is BIM that you can have the spatial model, but that's just one component. It's a data storage component that you can look at an object within that BIM model or that spatial model and say, what is your data? Those are like the starting pieces, but it is also that I can simulate my building. I can simulate my system. I can simulate my digital twin and see how it will perform in the future. That's super valuable for how do we engineer things, right? But more importantly than that, some of the AI technologies. So simulation is in AI, I'm going to introduce a word here called inference. So in AI, we talk about inferences. That's a way that you run your model. And a digital twin to us is an AI model. And so a simulation is what we call a deductive inference, meaning I'm going to deduct what's going to happen the next minute, the next hour, the next day. Those are deductive inferences. But what's really powerful is what we call abductive inferences. It's like reverse simulation. It's what if you could say to your digital twin, this is what I want to have happen an hour from now or a day from now. Now reverse simulate back to now. What are all of the control setups that I would need to make that happen?
Yeah.
And that starts to change the game.
Oh, yeah, it does. And very simplistically, I'm thinking, yeah, now you change your proportional band setups for control valves or whatever, not just set points, but it seems like you could actually have them reprogrammed based on what you want to have happen.
The audience here might be familiar with different approaches to this, whether it's you've got a proportional band or you got full PID or you've got some kind of model predictive control. But all of those are a form of hunt and peck, right? Where you're like, I'm going to try out something.
Yeah.
To see if it gets the right result. No, it didn't quite get the right result. Try something else. And you hunt around until you get to the point.
Error correction, right? You create an error and then you see that response. Right?
But if you can go backwards to, no, this is what I want. I want this kind of result in a room that back propagates, as we'd say in AI, back to the VAV box, that then gives you this kind of damper opening that back propagates to the actuator that back propagates to like, what is the control that I give it? Now all of a sudden you do it like one shot instead of thousands or millions.
Gives a whole new meaning to predictive maintenance, doesn't it?
Yeah, for sure. So that is like one of these key components of when we say digital twins, we think of digital twins not only as this thing that the installer or the engineer can design, you know, take a pump, connect it to a boiler, connect it to a buffer tank, that those digital twins that you drag and drop and connect, those are really accessible, like they're physical objects that we know. But what you're building is actually the AI model that actually gets directly computed. There's no translation. So that's different than do I BIM in the cloud? That's just a spatial model, right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. It really does. And it's really interesting the way it leverages the whole power of AI, right? It sounds subtle, but I get this as a profound difference. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, there's this space that Passive Logic is working in that's in between what is controls today.
Yeah.
And then what is also the AI of today, which is a little bit different. We had to innovate a whole new kind of AI because if you use ChatGPT, if your audience is familiar with that, ChatGPT is what we call a monolithic model, meaning that you train one giant model about the language of everything you can find on the internet. You could just scrape the internet for all this language. Now, the reason ChatGPT works so well is we have to like dial in something here that humans for thousands and thousands of years have been going around labeling things. Oh, that's a chair, that's a table, that's a pump, right? In different languages. And then the last 30 years, humans have been putting all that language on the internet. And now you can scrape the whole thing and you can train a huge monolithic model that looks smart. It's not really smart. It just has seen so much that it's what we'd call interpolating. Like your question is going to be similar to all kinds of questions it would have seen, and it can give a pretty good answer. Right. We all need to realize that language is the only place that you can grab 10,000 years worth of human history and just completely read that in bulk to train a model. No other industry has that advantage. So now you have to think, wow, okay, monolithic models aren't going to do it. We need these sort of composable models that I take a air handler and I take a chiller plant and I connect those together and I generate my own model. And that's the power of digital twins, why they're really important to make what we call generative autonomy.
Versus monolithic, the way they did ChatGPT. Okay. So it's taken the logic of something like ChatGPT AI, but now you're giving it a different set of variables, which I think probably allow for more accurate predictions, right? Because you're not putting everything in, you're putting a subset of everything.
Right. You're composing, as we call it, like chunks of your own model and generating your own custom model, as opposed to having this monolithic model that's just very generic, right? And there's no way to train across all buildings and then apply it to one. Right. Like buildings are different. That's what's unique about our profession. So that's what digital twins really allow us to do, is have what we call composable AI.
Love it. Love it. That's so cool, Tori. So cool. Now, listen, last time we talked, one of the really cool features, and if this is something you don't want to get into now because it's going to be at the event, but it was like the whole installation process for your product was different than most. Could you walk us through a little bit about what makes Passive Logic different in terms of how you guys install the system?
Yeah, it's talking about from digital twins to this, one of the key things that Passive Logic has focused on is we realize that we as installers and integrators and HVAC and mechanical companies, that nobody's really thought about our process, our business. It's always been like foisted upon us to make things go, but never the tools to make our business easier. So we really worked with a lot of the community to ask the questions, what's your workflow look like? And let's use that workflow in Autonomy Studio to make these AI technologies, these autonomous systems technologies, just part of that workflow so that we're not just giving you better control, smarter control, but we're actually accelerating or automating the workflow that is part of the back office work or the field work of what we have to do in getting an automation system plugged in. So that's been crucial to our whole path. And we're actually looking forward to more of the community engaging and giving us their feedback and what they want out of this, because I think this has been a joint effort between us and the community. How do we build tools that not only bring the community up to 2023, but having them forward facing, of being able to say, what if we could do this? What if we could do that? Wouldn't that be awesome? And that's what Passive Logic's really been about.
So cool. So cool. Nuts and bolts stuff. So you guys are obviously an open system, but do you guys use like Niagara as a front end? What languages, protocols do you guys talk? All that good stuff.
Yeah. So that's super good question. So obviously the core, the engine of this is where there's a lot of opportunities for innovation. But we are a big believer in open interfaces. And so we, while the Hive control platform is its own platform from the ground up, built on a Linux subsystem, as you'll find out in our show, and we can talk a little bit about, the whole thing's been built in the Swift programming language. That then has interfaces on the top side and the bottom. So the bottom side is, how do we connect to all the things that we have in the building? And that's your backnets and your Modbuses and your KNXs and your Bluetooth meshes. And so one of the things that digital twins really allow is better scalability of how do we talk different languages? Mm-hmm. Because the digital twin's interested in what something is. Protocols are, how do I talk in a certain language? And those are at different angles to each other, right? And, but it turns out it helps to say, this is the, I need 2000 cubic feet per minute of a certain temperature. That's the digital twin type of thinking of what I want from an air handler. Where backnets turn this point on, right?
Yeah.
Turn this point on tells me nothing, but if, so that makes it hard to translate across languages. But if you have a digital twin up here that's thinking 2000 cubic feet per minute at 48 degrees, then it's easy to go down to BACnet, 0 to 10 volts, Modbus, all similarly, because those are abstracted to what you actually want down to what language you speak. And those languages are all different levels of abstraction depending on which language.
So it's like you are a genius, right? You speak all these different languages. So you calculate what you need in terms of that, but then you're able to put it in whatever language the system needs to understand, to take care of the command you gave it.
Right. And so we call that semantic lowering. So that comes from the compiler industry, where in programming languages, you have high level programming languages, maybe like Swift or Python, and then you lower it down to machine language. And so we think of, say, BACnet is like machine language, right? It's turn this point on at this address. That's very low level detail. What I want to think about is, what do I need out of the system, like physically?
Right. So, makes a lot of sense.
That's the bottom side. That's the, how do we connect to all of the devices and IoT and the sensors? And we're very dedicated to really supporting the world's languages out there. And we think that those languages keep on expanding. We see residential languages making their way into the commercial systems. We need to support this broad set of languages. To that, we've hired the leader of the International BACnet Committee as our BACnet subsystem engineer. So we're very committed to these different interfaces. On the top side of our control platform, then you have this question of, well, what do you talk on the top side? And what we found was, there's a missing high-level API for buildings. We don't have one as an industry, and that's a huge problem. So Quantum, our digital twin technology, we decided to open that to industry last year. We have a lot of collaborators from the building owners all the way down to equipment manufacturers. And the reason for this is that a digital twin makes a perfect high-level API for how do I plug in all the services that I want into buildings. And that, just to expose how complicated that's been, we meet with all kinds of other technology companies and other startups, and you can make the most simple of apps. I'll tell you one that we got introduced to a few years ago. Is the guy who started a company called Compy. They've since sold themselves to Siemens. But it was literally a two-button app. You'd say warmer, colder.
Remember
and
Compy.
And it crowdsourced. Yeah, you remember this one?
Oh, yeah.
So it crowdsourced from everybody. Do they want it warmer or colder? This is, from a programming perspective, a really easy thing to implement. The guy who founded the company, super smart, right? Like a PhD from Berkeley in computer science. And what they found was, while that app you could build in a week, to connect it to any given building was 25,000 and up just to integrate into the systems. And everybody in this industry who's tried to put in an analytics package knows this. Like you just put in a basic analytics package and it's pretty hard to install that and get it integrated for less than 50K. That should be free, right? It should be no effort. And the reason that it costs something is we're missing this high-level API. Mm. So Quantum, we're rolling out not only in the Quantum Alliance, but in a bunch of tools that allow you to very quickly build applications that become a one-click exercise to add it to the next building.
That is really cool. One of the themes, Troy, seems to be, because obviously there's the cost of the product, but then there's the cost of installation and maintenance. And it seems, and correct me if I'm wrong, you guys are really dialed into the most efficient way to install, commission, and service a system after it's done. Is that a fair statement?
It's a fair statement. I mean, I think, Eric, what I continue to see very recently, I was in a few events, and what I see is this bifurcation, right? There's the install community, and we think about controls and automation and these boxes that are connected to all of the different wires and the wireless infrastructure of a building. And then there's all these other people who we're enabling, and they don't know what we do, right? It's down in the basement, in the closet, or up in the top floor right below the cooling tower. And what we find is that those guys just want solutions, right? They want analysis solutions. They want management solutions to manage their buildings. They want ESG solutions. And they want all these magic solutions of software that could only be fueled by the controls that we install. But the two communities are separate. They don't really wholly acknowledge one another as existing. So what we need to do is really connect those up and recognize on the building side, for them to get what they want, first, we as installers of controls need to get what we need. And only then these two things talking the same language can solve the real problems that we have in the building industry. And so we're really focused on that. And we see that in, say, Passive Logic's investors, right? We have investors that go from the industrial controllable side of things, like companies like Belimo, to we now in our investor pool have some of the biggest building companies in the world representing both US and Europe and partners in the Asian market as well, that between them all represent this huge part of the building industry. And so why did they invest in Passive Logic? They're looking how to get digital transformation. And Passive Logic today is the only way possible of what's out there in the field to get there. And so it's not just a controls problem, it's the rest of the end-to-end workflow of how do we make digital twins go from one side to the other side of design all the way to management.
So, man, Troy, this sounds so great, but I got to tell you, it's scary too. I know, for example, Uber drivers and people like that, not that our people in our industry are much more sophisticated than those folks, but they hear Elon Musk and the automated car coming out and they're thinking, there goes my job, right? Is it going to be so disruptive that the players we know it today, the guy out there is a systems integrator or whatever, is going to wake up 6 months from now and all of a sudden he's going to be out of business? Or is this going to be something that's going to be good for everybody?
So it's a super good question. And I think for us, what we see is AI as an enabling technology to help the community both scale their businesses, do more jobs, have those jobs go right more of the time, and be able to use more of the workforce that they have in-house today. And what there's a few components to this. So first, we think that what's different about automation is automation's not going to go, a BMS is not going to go install itself in a building by itself, right? You're going to need a labor force to do that. Today, when we work with the different players across the industry, from mechanical firms to these larger integrator firms, we hear the same story over and over again. That today they feel like BMS is actually a big risk in their industry, in their businesses. And it puts their business at sometimes this question of, are they going to make 5% on a job or lose 20% on a job? And so how do we turn this into, we're always making 20% on a job and there's no question that we're going to lose on that job? So part of that is there's not enough labor out there that can do the automation that we have. It's very specialized, very expertise driven. And let's be honest, if buildings are the most complex systems in the world, we need the best programmers in the world. And today the technology is so out of date that those programmers are going somewhere else. So we need to do two things. First, make our technology, like Passive Logic, exciting enough, you're drawing in the real smart talent. And then the second thing is making it easy enough to use that you're not just having two guys in the whole shop that could possibly program this, but all the 200 guys in your workforce can use this and use it productively. So we really think of AI, the potential, if you formulate it, if you build the tools for you, the users, then what you end up with is a democratization, right? And we need that democratization if we're going to ever scale BMS from this. What, let's be honest, it's today a pretty niche industry. When you look at the market statistics of how much penetration we're getting into the overall building market, to how do we get to 100% of the buildings, right? Because right now we're stuck up in the 3% of the buildings. And until we get to that 100% of the buildings, we're just not really going at volume in this industry. So that's how we see AI. We see AI as this enabler for how do we do our jobs better and do it more profitably and do it with all of the workforce that we've got.
Oh, it sounds great, Troy. And I think just statistically, the number of buildings in the U.S. and across the planet that don't have any form of energy control. And I think you might have just hit on something, because ultimately this is sold to business people that are making business decisions. And one of the things I heard that I think makes sense is, if I understood you correctly, you're saying that they look at this and they go, we're making a business investment that, yeah, it's hit or miss. In other words, the odds aren't necessarily great. I'm better off taking the money and putting it in an S&P fund someplace and letting it grow that way. But what I hear you saying is with your system, it's going to be more predictable. And because it's more predictable, more of the marketplace is going to be willing to invest in building automation controls.
That's right. I think we think about guarantees, and we think about guarantees all the way down. So what do digital twin based designs give you? They give you guarantees that when it goes into the field, that the system can validate whether or not it's installed correctly, right? That when you wire it, those digital twins are checking the wiring and giving you guarantees. Was it wired correctly? Now, these are mistakes that I've probably made myself. It's not just about the most junior guy making the wiring, just switching wires in the field and screwing up the system. We can't figure out what's going on. But those sort of error corrections along the way of how do we make our workflow smart enough that it's working for us, not just being an effort that's been away working against us, right? It's not like the systems today are working against us per se, but they're not helping us get the job done. And this is about how do we help the integrators and the installers out there bring them the tools that other big companies have. And I think what's worth realizing is if we don't do it in our industry, somebody else is going to come in and eat our lunch.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. And Troy, I'm seeing this as somewhat different. I think you're giving people the tools. And the analogy I might use is you're a systems integrator, and it's before computers, you're smart, you're using calculators, you're using whatever it takes to get the job done. And then all of a sudden you're coming in and now you're getting a laptop. It's not that the laptop's going to replace you, because you still got to know the stuff to put in, and you got to know how the buildings work, right? But the play that I'm really seeing here is, and maybe speak to you a little bit to your background, but over and over I hear about you being in Silicon Valley, right? Over and over I hear you talking about NVIDIA, you're talking about Microsoft, you're talking with all these people. And what I'm looking at is an opportunity for the great people in our industry to follow along with your product and all of a sudden now be in the limelight, right? Meaning that right. Because you're going to introduce them, you got a whole different set of friends, right? That have these buildings and have the money and the wherewithal. If they get the right technology, they're more likely to create. I look at you maybe as somebody that's generating business for all of us.
That's right. And so there's two parts to this. I'm going to talk about the Silicon Valley side and then talk about that business generation side. So what's super incredible to me, and you'll see this in part of the event, we're going to have an Apple engineer at our event who's doing a demonstration of our AI technology as the fastest in the world. Why is that interesting? It is the first time Apple has allowed an engineer to participate at somebody else's event. Apple famously only does their own events. Wow, this is the building automation industry, and we're the first time Apple is allowing their engineering team to be presenting at another company's event. So what we see is that's huge. That's huge for this industry of, we see buildings as the biggest industry in the world with the coolest set of robotics challenges, with the coolest set of technology that we can bring to any other market that we could possibly choose. And so lifting up building automation, what we're all doing so that the Apples of the world are interested and the NVIDIAs of the world are interested in the building market, this is only good for all of us. On the second point is, as we get all of this backing from big real estate owners throughout the world, who are trying to do digital transformation here doesn't mean just what building automation looked like in the past. It looks like a whole suite of new things. If I say to you, I'm going to give you an autonomous platform that is generative, that you can design for anything, people just start dreaming about what becomes possible. So that that grows up the industry. We get expansion of what kinds of projects are being brought into the fold that then drive down to the installers and the integrators to go do. Because we're a manufacturer, we're not the integrator, right? So we're pretty excited about what's coming down the pike that's gonna feed the marketplace and feed some of the job creation in this space.
Oh, awesome. All right, Troy, we got to tell people about the event here. So give me the date again and the time, and how do they get on the event?
Yeah, so November 2nd, they can go to passivelogic.com and just register for the event and live stream. They'll be able to watch it. It'll be available after the fact as well. But we're excited to have you guys come in and be a part of what we're doing for the building automation world.
That's exciting, Troy. Man, listen, got to get you to come back. Let's try to make this a quarterly or at least a semi-annual event. I know you're moving at the speed of light. Troy, this is exciting, man. Congratulations. Appreciate you, brother. And thanks for coming on the show.
Yeah, thanks, Eric.
That's Troy Harvey, the founder and CEO of PassiveLogic.com. Be sure to check him out November 2nd. Be there or be square. All right, there you go, man. That's another week on Control Talk Now, your smart buildings video cast and podcast. Thank you so much for tuning in. We'll be back next week. Until then, remember, be bold, stay in control, stay relevant. As Hunter Thompson used to say, buy the ticket, take the ride. And as Kenny Smyers used to say, indeed. Have a great week.